the second chapter, we are going to study about a couple of elements of a machine. So this particular second chapter is about designing for joints. Third chapter is about designing for bearings. Next chapter is about designing of clutches and brakes. Then for next one is for gears, and then next one is for springs. So we are going to see these many number of elements of a machine in this particular subject of machine design. So basically, we are going to apply the concepts of SOM in a practical way for each and every element. So we are going to consider, we are going to drop the ideal assumptions, and then we consider the real things into consideration. So example, in the first chapter, we started with the extra concept called as a new concept called as stress concentration. So we have seen that, like, if you are going with the ideal assumptions which we have taken in the subject of SOM, so we might get the results that the metal will not fail. But we are seeing that stress concentration is a phenomena which is very, very dangerous, and we should be taking care of that. So in that way, we'll be deviating from, or we'll be stopping our assumptions regarding, or we'll be stopping our discussion regarding, or discussion in ideal case, and we'll be doing a discussion in a practical way in the subject of machine design. Fine. So I was telling that in the previous lecture, we went with the subject of we started with the subject of machine design, and we are done with the chapter of first chapter, that is design for static and dynamic loading. And then we started with this second chapter in the last half an hour of the previous class. So there we started with the second chapter, that is designing of joints. So today we'll go with this particular chapter itself. After this chapter, we are going to study about designing for bearings. Then we are going to study about designing for clutches and brakes. Then we are going to study about designing of spur gears, then designing of springs. So we are going to study about these number of elements in this particular subject. So basically, what we are doing in this subject is we are dropping down the ideal way or ideal assumptions, or we are dropping down the ideal assumptions in doing calculations regarding force, stress and area, and taking care of real applications into real situations into consideration. So when we started dealing with the real things or real effects in day-to-day life, we understood one important concept called as stress concentration. In that way, we are going to see many, many new things in coming chapters and also in this particular chapter. So this is the way in which we are going to study machine design. So machine design is all about application of SOM circuit only, but dropping down the ideal assumptions and going with practical assumptions, or the practical limitations we are going to have when we are dealing with a material or an element in real life scenario. That's a approach for this particular subject of machine design. So we started with the second chapter, designing of joints, and I said that we have three parts or three types of joints in our syllabus, that is designing for riveted joints, then bolted joints, then welded joints. I also said that this particular riveted joints cover 80% of this chapter, and bolted and this particular welded joints will be covering up only 20%, remaining 20% of this particular chapter. Now, in the previous chapter itself, or in the previous class itself, we have studied that this particular riveting operation is done in such a way that it is going to be a permanent joint, and the rivet should be made up of a ductile material, and it is very different with respect to a pin joint. So because in this particular riveted joint, there will be no relative motion between the plates once they are joined. But whereas when you are dealing with a pin joint, there can be relative motion between the plates, and they can rotate about the axis of the pin very easily. So there's a huge difference between a riveted joint and a pin joint, and also we have seen some advantages of a riveted joint, or very important assumptions, very important advantages of a riveted joint. We have seen that it is a leak proof joint, it's going to make a joint as a rigid joint, it is vibration proof, it can be used where the applications of in the applications where there is a problem of welding is there. So wherever welding cannot be done, we can simply go ahead with this riveted joint. Due to these applications, or due to these advantages, though riveted joint is a very, very old joint, it is being used in the same level till today in our applications. Okay, so if you go to any industry, definitely you are going to see that riveted joint application is there in some way, or in some location of a machine where we are related to joining two elements. Understood? So that is the importance of riveted joint. Okay, so now we are going to start with the terminology of the riveted joints. So we are going to see the basic terms we are going to study in a riveted joint, or we are going to encounter in study or designing of a riveted joint. So you can see the first picture in this particular secondary screen here. So there is a letter T, there is a letter D, and there's a letter P and also M. So first of all, let's come to the letter T. So T is very obvious. So it's obvious from the diagram that T is nothing but this is the thickness of a plate. So whatever the plate is there, the thickness of the plate is taken as T. And D is the diameter of the shank part of the rivet. So you have to keep in mind that it is also called, or it's mostly called with the name design, it's also called or mostly called with the name of diameter of the rivet directly. Okay, so instead of using the word as diameter of a shank, we'll be using it as diameter of the rivet itself. Clear? So kindly keep in mind that whenever they say it's a diameter of a rivet, that means it's a diameter of the shank part. Clear? Because obviously diameter of the head, if you take it, it will be different with respect to a diameter of a shank. So the diameter of the shank is taken as diameter of the rivet. So T and D are done. The next one is P. Sorry, first of all, we should go with the M before going to P here. So M, if you see, that is called as margin. So T is plate thickness. So D is diameter of the rivet. Okay, so D is the diameter of the rivet. And next one, D is the diameter of the rivet. And next one is M. So M means margin. So I hope you people remember that we encountered this term margin when we are using notebooks in our high school level or primary school level. So we used to leave some gap from the left corner of the left edge of the page, and then from there we used to start. So we call that particular gap as margin. So same thing here also. So when we are joining two plates, so I'm joining two plates like this. So from your left, if you look here, so I can simply put the rivet here, or I can put the rivet here. I'll put the diagram here. Look everybody. So this is one plate. So this is kept over another plate like this. So now one plate is kept over the other. So I should do the riveting operation to join them. So I can put the row of rivets exactly here, very near to the edge, or I can keep it little bit far away from the edge, this particular distance here. So if you see here, the first distance, this one is very, very less. So if the distance is very, very less, what happens is there is a very high chance that the whatever the hole we made for inserting the rivet, that hole can propagate crack towards the edge of this particular plate here. So that can cause tearing of the plate. So this is very, very important thing which you should be taking care while doing the riveting operation. So what you should be doing to avoid this, you should keep this row of rivets, at a optimum distance from the edge of the plate here. It should not be like it's very far from the edge. Okay, so it should not be like very near from the edge. So it should be kept at optimum distance so that this particular problem is not going to occur, or this particular problem is avoided or eradicated here. Understood? So this particular distance of this row of rivets from the edge of the plate is called as margin, and it is denoted by M. You can see there. In the same way, if you see, there is a distance between the plates as well. There is optimum distance between the rivets as well, not the plates. There is optimum distance between the rivets as well. This particular distance, we call it as a pitch. Understood? So whatever the reason I said here, we should be keeping a margin. In the same way, they should be keeping an optimum distance between the rivets as well. There's a high chance that the holes which are made to insert the rivets can propagate cracks and cause the tearing of the plate. So to avoid tearing of the plate, margin, optimum margin should be maintained, and also optimum pitch distance also should be maintained between the rivets. Understood? So M is the margin and P is the pitch. You can write down. So M is margin. So P is nothing but pitch. So M is margin and P is pitch here. Clear? So M is margin and P is pitch. Now, if you see the second diagram in this particular secondary screen, clear? In the secondary screen, if you see here, there is another extra term that is given by P suffix T. If you see the second diagram, there is T, there is D, there is M, there is P. Along with all these four, there is extra another letter given by P suffix T. So this is also pitch here, but this is in transverse direction. So we took this particular direction as long tunnel direction. So perpendicular to long tunnel, we will be calling it as transverse direction. So in this direction also pitch is taken. That will be coming only when there are more than one row of rivets. If you see the second diagram, there are more than one row of rivets. So the way in which we have maintained distance, okay, the way in which we have maintained optimum distance between the rivets along this direction, in the same way, when you are doing double riveting, that means like two rows of riveting, you should be maintaining optimum distance in this direction as well, and we will call, we'll be calling that particular distance as transverse pitch. Clear everyone? Understood? So PT is called as transverse pitch. In the third diagram, you see another extra letter or extra term given by P suffix D. So you can understand why it is coming up. So when you are arranging rivets in a zigzag fashion, so if you see the second picture, we call that particular arrangement as chain riveting fashion or chain riveting basically, and we'll be calling the third type of fashion as zigzag riveting fashion. So when you are keeping in a zigzag fashion, so there should be optimum distance in the diagonal direction as well. So we denote that one by P suffix D, and that particular pitch is called as diagonal pitch. So this particular pitch is called as diagonal pitch. Understood? So these are the terms which you should be keeping in mind. Clear? And sometimes like they will not be instead of giving a picture or a diagram, they'll be directly using these terms. So from reading out these terms from the question, you should be able to understand what exactly they mean. Understood everybody? Clear? You guys can take the screenshot of this particular secondary screen. So if the screenshot taking is done, we'll go ahead with the next slide. Why are we using zigzag fashion instead of a simple one? Whatever we are changing, whatever we are the fashion of the riveting operation we are choosing, whether it is single row of riveting, double row of riveting, again after double row we can choose, or we can either go with chain riveting or we can go with zigzag riveting. Clear? We can in fact go with three rows of riveting also. Sometimes you are going to see four rows of riveting. Whatever change we are doing, whatever the fashion of the riveting operation we are choosing, that is completely based upon the load carrying capacity of the joint. If you think that one row of riveting operation will not help you to carry out the load, then we'll go with two rows of riveting. Now it comes to two rows of riveting, we have when it comes to two rows of riveting, double row, double riveting operation, we can have a chain riveting fashion or zigzag riveting fashion. So if you found that like one of the particular fashion is helping you to carry more amount of load, then we opt for the particular fashion of riveting. Clear? Where the stress concentration effect is there, because anyways we are going to decrease the cross-sectional area of the plates at the rivet holes. Okay, so we'll discuss regarding that thing later. Why this angle on plate edge? So that is not compulsory. Clear? So basically after few slides we are going to see about an operation called as fullering operation. So if the plate is little bit inclined, it will become easy for you to do the operation and make it 100% leak proof. So I hope you people remember that in the previous class I said that there are two operations called as caulking and fullering, which can help you to make a livered joint 100% leak proof. So if it is little inclined by 10 degrees, we can use that operation to make 100% leak proof. If it is not 10 degree, if it is 0 degrees, then the plate edge will be vertical with respect to the horizontal surface, then it will become very difficult for you to do the operation. So I'll show you the video and also the picture when we discuss about the particular concept. Okay, so let's go ahead. You guys can copy this formula here. Once you are done with copying of this formula, I'll explain you what is the use of this formula and why we are going with this formula and how they are actually coming up. Can you copy everyone whatever is there on the slide? So whenever your query is clear, kindly just acknowledge so that I can have an idea that you don't have that doubt anymore. I can go ahead for the next query or the next concept. Clear? So everybody done? Okay. So everybody listen carefully here. The relation between, mathematical relation between margin, this diameter of the rivets, thickness of the plates, pitch, etc. are given by this formula here. Please remember that these formulae are not derived. Okay, these are empirical formulae. So empirical formulae means based upon your experimental experience, you will be designing a formula. Understand? So many people ask me, or many people have a doubt, what exactly is an empirical formula? I would like to put in this simple way here. I hope at least few people know cooking of at least rice. Okay, or if you don't know cooking also, you have a basic idea that if you have to, or if you'd like to boil rice, you'll be keeping volume of rice and volume of water for boiling in the ratio of 1:2 respectively. Am I right? Yes. So there is no science behind this. Okay, so this thing is not decided based upon some chemical reactions and chemical equations. Clear? And if you find out the variety of rice is requiring more amount of water, sometimes you put 1:2.25. Okay, so you put some half glass of water more. Am I right? Understood? Okay, so I was telling that these relations which are shown on the secondary screen are actually empirical relations. Empirical relations are those relations which are not derived, or which are not actually given based upon some derivation. So they are given based upon experimental experience. Clear? So I was giving an example that if you want to boil rice, generally you'll be keeping rice to water ratio of 1:2. Clear? So it is not given based upon some chemical reactions or some research. Okay, so this was actually discovered, or this is being followed from early man time. Clear? So from thousands of years. So the time when man started growing rice and cultivating rice. So from then he started using this technique of boiling rice using in a 1:2 ratio. Clear? So it came up with an experience. So once they started with a trial and error method, like boiling rice by 1:1 ratio, then they slowly increased to 1:2 ratio, like that. And they understood that, like, for a particular rice, it should be 1:2. So if based upon the rice variety, if you are experiencing any problem, if you are finding out that rice is being very dry, even after boiling, you have to put more amount of water. So if you ask your mother, definitely she'll be telling you that she does iterations, little amount of iterations, whenever your father finds out or purchases a different type of rice. So if there is no change of variety of rice, then she won't need to worry about that. Clear? So people have to understand that these are empirical relations and there is no proof for them. And based upon the experimental experience, these are given here. You can see here, first relation between D and T. Diameter of a rivet is decided based upon thickness of a plate. For example, if you remember, using a stapler, we'll be joining papers. So like we'll be punching a pin using a stapler. For example, if you have 2 to 3 papers, 3-4 A4 sheets, you can simply use a small stapler or a small staple to join them very easily. But if you have a bunch of papers, like some 20 papers, 30 papers, which are very, very thick, so then you'll be using a bigger stapler, or you'll be using a bigger pin or bigger staple to join those particular plates or particular papers. Am I right? The same way you're going to decide for this one as well. Based upon the thickness of the plate, you're going to decide the diameter of the rivets. Understand? So the optimum diameter of the rivet which you should be using to join those corresponding plates is given by the Unwin's formula. D is equal to 6√T. Another thing you have to keep in mind, that these empirical relations need not to be dimensionally correct. If you take dimension of the LHS of this particular formula, the first formula, D is given in millimeters, right? But if you see the right side formula, it is in the root millimeters. So you see that empirical relations no need to follow the dimensional equality. If you take F is equal to ma, so what are the units of force is there, Newton's second law of motion, same unit should be there for m into a as well. Understand? So dimensionality should be correct for every formula, but it is no longer valid for a formula which is an empirical type. Clear, everybody? Understood? So D is equal to 6√T, which is given by Unwin, and it is also called as Unwin's formula. And kindly keep in mind that this is valid, or this can be applied only for the case where thickness of the plate is more than 8 millimeters. If your thickness of plate is less than 8 millimeters, I'll be letting you know what is the formula you have to use in the coming slides. Clear, everybody? Understood? So there's a formula, first formula of this particular slide, which is very, very important, you should be keeping in mind. Sometimes, till now in GATE questions, no question, till now in the past 31 years of GATE papers, no question came which was indirectly expecting you to use Anil's formula, but there is definitely a chance that question might come where they'll be expecting you to apply the Anil's formula, giving that T is more than 8 millimeters. Understood? So they will give you only thickness of the plate, and they will be expecting you, they will be expecting you to derive the thickness of the diameter of the rivet here. So you should be remembering this Anil's formula, and keep in mind that this is valid only for when the diameter of the, sorry, thickness of the plate is more than 8 millimeters. And remaining formula, that is pitch should be thrice the diameter of the rivet, and margin should be 1.5 times D, and transverse pitch is equal to 0.8 times pitch in chain riveting, and it should be 0.6 times pitch with zigzag riveting. So these are the formula here. So till now, no gate question came where they expected you to use these formula from your memory. In every question for the past 31 years, they've given the questions directly. But if you take test series of the Gate Academy of any or any other institute, we keep questions so that you will be knowing these formulae. Because in Gate 2020 or 21, if a question is coming, which is an unexpected question came on these formulae, you should be able to tackle them. Just because of the small mistake that you haven't remembered these formulae, you should not be losing marks. Clear, everybody? So kindly keep in mind to remember this formulae here. Understood, everybody? Okay, so let's go ahead. If you are doing the classification of riveted joints, they are classified in this broad way as shown in this particular flow chart or classification chart in the secondary screen. So you can see here, there is a lap joint. So that means riveted joints are basically divided first of all into lap joint and a butt joint. Lap joint, butt joint means what? So lap joint means one over the other. Okay, so he's sitting on my lap. So she's sitting on my lap. Okay, so they are, so the kid is sitting on my lap. So one over the other. Understand? So always keep in mind, lap joint means one over the other. So we'll be keeping one plate over the other and we'll be doing the riveting operation. So in that way, we'll be joining it. So butt joint means keeping the two joining plates adjacent to one another. So lap joint means one over the other, and butt joint means they'll be kept one adjacent to other. But when you are keeping one adjacent to other, you cannot do the riveting operation easily to join the two plates. So what you should be doing in a butt joint is you'll be using covering plates. So these covering plates you'll be calling as strap plates. So if I draw a lap joint, this will be looking like this. So one plate is kept over the other plate. One plate is kept over the other plate here. So if you see the top view, it will be looking like this. So this plate is on the top and this plate is like this. It is like this. So if you do the riveting operation, it will come like this. So rivet will be inside. So I'm using, or I'm showing you only single rivet here. So lap joint will be looking like this. Now when it comes to a butt joint, these two plates should be kept one adjacent to other. So they should be kept adjacent to one another like this. And then you should be using strap of plates. So extra strap of plates. There are different material plates you can use. You can use same material or different material plates as well. So you can use again only one strap, or you can use double strap. You can look here. So I'm using a double strap here, or two straps. One strap over the plates and one strap bottom of the plates here. And I'm doing the riveting operation here. So riveting operation will be like this. So you should be using a minimum of two rows of rivets. Because if I use only this riveting operation or one row of riveting operation, then I can't join this plate and this plate. The objective is to join this plate and this plate here. So the joining is only possible, you can see from the diagram, only when I'm using a minimum two rows here. Understood? So I can go ahead with only one strap of plates. Okay, I can skip using the bottom strap plate here, but I cannot skip using another row of rivet here. Understand? Clear, everybody? So if you see the top view, the rivets or the plates will be looking like this. You can see here. Understand, everyone? Okay, so if you see the classification of lap joints, so there is single riveted, double riveted. Single riveted means single row of riveted. Okay, single row of riveting operation. So if there is only single row of riveting operation, we call it as a single riveted lap joint. If there are double row, we'll be calling it as double riveted lap joint. And once it becomes a double riveted, so what happens is it might be a chain riveting operation or it can be a zigzag riveting operation. Am I right? Okay, so we can have either chain riveting operation or zigzag riveting operation. So you can have either chain type riveting or zigzag type riveting. Now come to the butt joint here. So here if you see this classification, there is single row and double row. What exactly they mean by single row? Getting clarified now. You will get your doubt clarified now. Single row means single row of rivets per plate. So I'm concerned about the plates which are being joined here. So I would like to join this plate with this plate here. So for this plate is concerned, there should be one row of rivet. So for this plate, when there is one row of rivets, or then I'll be calling it as single riveting butt joint or single riveted butt joint here. So you should not be confused with this thing. So totally on this particular riveting operation of this particular butt joint, there are two rows. That doesn't mean that it's going to be a double riveted butt joint here. So there are one row of rivets per plate, then we should be calling it as single riveted butt joint itself. Understand? Now you can have double rows as well. When it becomes double row, we can have chain riveting or zigzag riveting. And also when it becomes this particular straps, when it coming to the number of straps here, we can either have single strap or we can have either double strap here. So if you take any riveting joint or any riveted joint, it is basically the name of the riveted joint basically is given based upon few terms. First thing is should be given whether it's a lap joint or a butt joint. Once it is decided whether it is a lap joint or a butt joint, then it should be decided whether how many number of rows are there. That means whether it's a single riveted, double riveted, or triple riveted, and so on like that. Clear? After that, if it is coming, if it is butt joint here, we should be conveying about the number of straps. So whether it is single strap or double strap. Clear, everybody? And other thing, and the last one is, if there are more than one row of rivets, we should be clearly telling whether it is zigzag riveting or chain riveting. So based upon these four terms, the name for a riveted joint is given completely. So if you don't have the diagram also, based upon these four things, you can expect or you can imagine how the diagram is going to be, and you can even solve the question as well. Understood? So let's see some examples from that you can understand very easily. If you see this particular picture, it is very obvious that it's going to be, it's actually a lap joint, and there is a single row of riveting operation here. So it is single riveted lap joint. Understood? You guys can take screenshots. You don't need to copy here. Why we use term row, since they are riveted in column manner. Okay, so basically in a table, vertical things are called as columns and horizontal things are called as rows. Okay, so this is not strictly followed here. Okay, this particular joint, you can see the joint on the secondary screen as well. So I kept the joint, I'm showing you the joint where the row of rivets are in the vertical formation. So you should be actually calling it as column. Am I right? Okay. I can tilt the same thing horizontally and have the rivets in horizontal direction as well. So the clear distinction between row and column words is no longer valid here. Understand? So generally, row is the word more prominently used as compared to column. So the terminology with respect to rows, not with respect to columns, came from olden days in this way itself. Understood? Yeah. So let's go ahead. You can see here, it is also a lap joint. There are two rows of rivets. Okay, so it's a double riveted lap joint. And these rows of rivets are arranged in chain fashion. So it is actually given the name as double riveted lap joint in chain. Understood? Now, same thing. I'm using two straps here. Single riveted butt joint with double strap. So single riveted, double strap, butt joint. Come on, everyone. So please remember to define these terms. So lap joint or butt joint. Okay. Next one is you have to define the number of rows, number of straps, so next thing is chain riveting or zigzag riveting. So these four terms you should be defining to give a name for a joint. Clear? So once it becomes a lap joint, this particular straps will no longer be valid. Understand? So these are the exhaustive list of all the parameters that should be defined here. Understand? Once it becomes a lap joint, number of straps become no longer valid, they will not be coming. So once it becomes a single row, chain riveting, zigzag riveting will no longer be valid there. Clear? Done? You can give the name for this one. Can you guys try? So you can see here, this is triple riveted, double strap, but joined in zigzag fashion. So you can give the name for this, triple riveted, double strap, but joined in zigzag fashion, and it is given the common name or general name as diamond joint. Can you take the screenshot of this? So till now no question came, but just remember that diamond joint is nothing but triple riveted butt joint with triple riveted double strap butt joint in zigzag fashion. Okay, so everybody done, right? I can go ahead with the next and the most important part of this chapter, or at least most important part in the designing in this particular part of rivets. Okay, everybody? Okay. So designing for riveted joints. Clear? So here we are going to apply the simple formula, that is force equal to stress into area. Or we are going to simply write down force equal to stress into area. All you have to do is you have to identify what type of stress that is being created in the part, whether it is a plate, it may be a plate, it may be a rivet. And then you have to define the area. What is the magnitude of the area here? So once you know what type of stress is there, or stress is being induced, what type of area is there, what is the magnitude of area is there, you can simply write down the relation between force, stress and area, and you can easily get the answer. That's all you have to do here. So here, very, very basic common sense here. There is nothing conceptual. Whatever you have learned in SOM, you're just going to apply here. Understood, everyone? So in designing of riveted joint, so first of all, we are going to design regarding or with respect to shear strength of a rivet. So please keep in mind that the title is given as, the first part of this designing of riveted joint is given the title as shear strength of the rivet. It is doesn't mean that we are going to get the shear strength of rivets. What we are going to do is, based upon the shear strength of the rivet, what is the maximum load carrying capacity? That's what we are going to find out here. I'm repeating once again, we are going with the first part of designing our riveted joints, that is shear strength of the rivet. Shear strength of the rivet means, it doesn't mean, first of all, that we are going to find out the shear strength of a rivet. Clear? We are actually going to find out, based upon the shear strength of the rivet, what is the maximum load carrying capacity. I hope everybody know that, the difference between stress and strength by now. I told that stress is induced value of stress, or basically load per unit area of cross section. So whatever the load is being applied, based upon that, what is the stress being produced there. So strength is the capacity. So beyond that, it will fail. So I've given you an example that if a coolie is there, or if a person is there, he can carry a load of 70 kg, let's assume. So till I give him a weight of 69.999 kilo, he will be able to carry. Once I give 70 kilo, he will fail, or he will fall down, or he cannot carry the load, basically. So whatever the load I'm giving to him, so 40 kg, 50 kg, 60 kg, 16.999, whatever the value is there, that is nothing but stress value, or it is equivalent to a stress value in a material. And the 70 kg, whatever his capacity is there, that is actually the strength value there. So stress can be any value. Based upon the applied load, we can create any value of stress. But strength value is exponential value. So strength of a person doesn't depend upon the applied load, am I right? In the same way, strength of a material does not depend on the applied load or applied or induced value of stress. It's exponential value. They will be giving you in the question. Without giving in the question, you cannot evaluate the value of strength. Understood? So we also studied in the first chapter that whenever we discover or invent a material, okay, so first of all, we'll be doing tensile testing, compression testing, shear testing, etc. So that we'll be clear about the strength of the material in various types of loadings. Understood? So here we are going to find out based upon the shear strength of the rivet, because we'll be knowing with what material the rivet is made up of. It will be definitely made up of some ductile material. So that particular ductile material will be having some shear strength. If you don't know, we can do the testing of the particular material in shear, and we can find out at what value of stress at what value of stress it is actually failing. So that becomes the strength of the material or shear strength of the material. So we'll be having that value given in the question. So based upon that, we are going to find out the maximum load carrying capacity. Now, if you take a single riveted or single riveted lap joint, so you can see the diagram there, there's only single rivets, okay? So, two plates are joined using a single rivets, okay? Now, if you take the cross-sectional view, there is a rivet here. Understand? Now, when I apply some force, so here I am going with the condition that force is applied in this way. Okay, force applied in this way here. So, when you apply this particular force, definitely this force is, you can observe that this particular force is parallel to the area of cross section of the rivet shank here. So, this will be giving rise to shear stress in the material of the rivet here. So this is going to cause stresses in the plate as well, but right now we are not discussing regarding the effects of this particular load on the plates. In the next part of this particular section, we are going to deal with the plate itself. Understood? Right now we are concerned about the rivet itself, what is being happened to the rivet itself. Clear? So if you see that the particular load is parallel to area of cross section of the shank or the rivet here, so this will be giving rise to shear stress. Now, once this load P is giving rise to a stress which is reaching the value of shear strength of the rivet here, what happens is this particular rivet will break. So here, please keep in mind that we are not concerned about yielding here, because I am not concerned about the material here, I am concerned about the joint. I would say the joint is failed when two plates are being separated, because the job's this particular joint responsibility, or the objective of this particular joint is to keep the materials or to keep the plates joined. These two plates should be joined. Understand? So these two plates, if they are being separated, then we say it got failed. So we have to make this particular rivet shank to get broken. So they'll be giving the strength value corresponding to the fracture point itself. So you don't need to worry. So whether it is a yield value or ultimate yield value or the fracture value there. So whatever they say as shear strength of the rivet material in the question, use that value. They don't confuse you regarding that thing. Understand everybody? Clear? So now if you write down the relationship between the load, stress and area in a simple way, you can write down load is equal to shear stress induced into area of cross section. It is very simple here. This means that for a particular value of load P, stress produced is tau. That's the meaning of this particular equation here. Understood? But this tau value cannot go beyond strength of the material. Understand? So, once it reaches strength of the material, the rivet will fail and the joint will fail automatically. So, we can write down maximum P, maximum load carrying capacity is equal to shear strength of rivet into area of cross section. Understood? So this is the relationship here. Understood everybody? Clear? There's a doubt by Mohammed Anas Khan Danish here. If yielding starts, then leakage will come, joint fail. Mohammed Anas Khan Danish, by any means, if it is not serving your purpose, if light leakage is happening also, it means it got failed. Understood? Okay, so but they will not be asking you that much at that level. They will not be asking you to confuse you there. Clear? So they give you the value of shear strength of the rivet, and they will ask you to get the value of maximum load. So all you have to do is find out the area, multiply with this strength here, and get the answer here. That's it. Whatever the way in which you're thinking is right, but they will not be asking you a question in that way or in that particular level, because in 31 years we haven't seen a question like that. Understood everybody? Clear? So I hope there is no doubt regarding this thing. Kindly copy this thing, make it fast. I'll take some other example to make you understand how to write down this relationship, how the relationship will change based upon or from joint to joint. Which area? This is nothing but what? Pi d squared by 4, area of cross section of the rivets. Understood? Because this area should break in terms of shear of a rivet so that the joint will fail. Done. I'm showing you another diagram here. I'll just change or bring the changes in this diagram itself. So I'm giving two rivets, same lap joint only. So what is the difference you are going to get in this equation here, in these two equations here, with respect to the previous equation? What is the change I should bring here in these two equations? Tell me. I want you people to think. Without thinking, you can't solve questions of this particular section with confidence. Okay, so thinking is very much required. It's all aptitude. Okay, it's all about it's not about mugging up the equation. Don't go ahead with the approach of mugging up the equations. So the only unfortunate thing is your way of approach will give you answer very easily, a right answer very easily for this case, but when it comes to other cases, it can cause complicatedness or it can cause confusion. Okay, so let's go with the normal approach itself. So here, if you would like to break the joint or fail the joint, you have to shear off two areas of cross section. For example, if I am able to shear off only one area of cross section, this particular P will be coming here. We are going with the complicated case now. So here we see that these two plates will get separated only when areas of cross section of the two rivets should get broken. If only one area of cross section gets broken, then that will not be sufficient enough to separate the two plates. So two areas should get sheared off here. So the only difference is you will get twice the area here and here. Understood? So initially, if the load carrying capacity is some 10 newton, now the load carrying capacity will reach 20 newton. Because of using of more number of rivets, we have to, due to the reason that we are using more number of rivets, we have to shear off many areas of cross section. So load carrying capacity also increases. Understand? Going by your approach also, you'll get the same answer, this one itself. You'll be writing down P by 2 is equal to tau into A, P comes out to be tau into 2A itself. Clear? I hope there is no doubt. It's a very simple case here. Once you're done copying regarding this case, please let me know how many areas we have to shear off, how many minimum number of areas we have to shear off in the diagram shown on the secondary screen, the below diagram.